Hello everyone, in this video I'm going to tell you about appendicitis, and basically I'll start from appendix. What is its anatomy, physiology, and then I will go to acute appendicitis, its etiology, pathogenesis, and certain clinical forms, and everything that you need to know about acute appendicitis. So appendicitis is basically the inflammation of the appendix, and it can be acute or it can be chronic. So what is the appendix? As we already know that appendix is also known as vermiform appendix, because the vermiform name is given because of its shape. It is worm like in shape, so the vermiform name is given to the appendix, and it is intraperitoneally located, so it is located within the peritoneal cavity. Also, the length of the vermiform appendix is 8 to 10 cm, and this is the normal size. Like it can vary from person to person also, and the thickness is from 0.3 to 1 cm. And as you can see here, this is our ascending colon and this is our cecum part. So here ileum will be entering the cecum part, and this little structure here, it looks like a worm, so it is vermiform appendix. So the lumen is covered with the mucous membrane. The lumen of the vermiform appendix is covered with mucous membrane, which is rich in lymphatic follicles. So lymphatic follicular rich mucous membrane, you can say vermiform appendix is having. And its muscular layer, muscular membrane has two layers basically. One is longitudinal, which is present outside, and one is circular, which is internally present. So outside will be longitudinal muscular layer, and internally will be circular muscular layer. And about it, it's a submucous layer. As the submucous layer of vermiform appendix also have multiple lymphatic vessels and follicles also, just like the mucous membrane. So these are just the general, you can say, histology, the layers, structures. So what is the blood supply? So if we see the blood supply of the appendix, it is from appendicular artery. So appendicular artery is basically a branch of ileocolic artery. So it is an end artery. End artery means that if any thrombosis or anything, that anything occlusion or any other stuff happens in this artery, then it will result in gangrene or necrosis. It is not attached to any further artery. As you can see here, vermiform appendix is just lying vestigial. It is a vestigial organ, so it is just lying, just you can say, floating to the cecum part. So that's why appendicular artery is also attaching somewhere here and give its blood supply to the appendix. So now, in from person to person, the you can say appendix position varies. There are different position of appendix from like if for example, I am having a different position of appendix and someone else is having a different position of appendix. So the, what are the various you can say presentation of appendix? So they can be retrocecal. It is the most common. As retrocecal, it is present behind the cecum. As you can see here, it is present behind the cecum. It is the most common presentation of the appendix. Second, it can be subcecal. That is just below the cecal part and laterally to the cecum, it is present laterally. Then is the pelvic pelvic presentation, that is to the medially and also present below the cecum. Another is you can say posterior, that will, you know, it will be coming from behind the ileum. So behind the ileum it will be going, posterior. And pre-ileal, it will be in the front of the ileal part. So this is the normal anatomy and physiology related to appendix that you need to know. Now I'll start from acute appendicitis. So what is acute appendicitis? So acute appendicitis is the most common surgical emergency of the abdomen. So it is the most common surgical emergency that every emergency doctor faces, or you can say sees in his daily life, from patient to patient, because in most of the patient it is the surgical emergency once in a lifetime. Like every second person, once in a lifetime they will have this acute appendicitis in their life. And also it occurs in all ages, with peak incidence in teens and early 20s. So the peak incidence of acute appendicitis is in teens and in early 20 ages. So women are more you can say susceptible, or you can say it occurs more in women as compared to men. So what is the etiology? So the main etiology of the acute appendicitis is that there is disorder in neurohumeral regulation. So what is this neurohumeral regulation? That means the nerve fibers that are surrounding the appendix, somewhere there is injury in those neurohumeral regulation, and that will lead to the circulatory injury of the appendix. So what are these disorders that lead to the neurohumeral regulation dysfunction? These are groups, for example, three groups are categorized. First is sensibilization of organism. That means maybe due to some food allergy, bacteria, helminths that invades the vermiform appendix. Second is refractory way. For example, if there is any disease in any other part of the abdomen, example in stomach or in bladder, from there the bacteria will come and the infection will spread to the vermiform appendix. Or it can be direct irritation of the nerve endings, that is due to foreign body and fecolith, that is the fecal stone, you can say fecal stone, that get lodged into the vermiform appendix. So out of all these three, approx one third of all of them is caused by obstruction of appendix. So one by third of all of them is caused by obstruction of appendix, that is mainly due to fecal stones, as you have already, fecolith, and these are also known as coprolites. So fecal stone can cause obstruction of the appendix. Helminths can also cause obstruction, like if some worms will come and invade the appendix, and they can also cause obstruction, or some foreign bodies can also cause obstruction in the appendix. So this is the basic, you can say, etiology that we have to remember related to acute appendicitis. Now what is the pathogenesis? So pathogenesis, so basically obstruction occurs in the proximal part. So whenever there is obstruction occurring in the proximal part, the mucus secretion in the distal part will be continuing, it will not stop. So as the mucus is increasing in the proximal part and it can't get out because of the obstruction, mainly caused by these things, fecal stone, helminths and foreign bodies, then there will be increase in pressure in the lumen. The lumen pressure will increase, and these pressure will basically will be applying on the vessels, surrounding vessels nearby the appendix. There will be vessels and nerves surrounding it, so there will be pressure on those vessels, and due to this pressure only the pain appears. So the pain is mainly due to pressuring of the vessels and nerve which are surrounding the appendix. So in that area, as you already know that in our gut microflora, normally E. coli and bacteriodes are present. So if there is obstruction in the proximal part, then in the distal part, these E. coli and bacteriodes will multiply, and like other bacterias and other infective agents can come into this you can say inflamed area, or when the inflammation process starts. So when the inflammation process start, or our white blood cells come here, so then there will be pus formation will be there, and non-specific inflammatory process will start. And first of all it will be serous exudate, and in later stages it will be turned into purulent stages. So this is the main pathology. So the main thing that is we have to remember here is obstruction is taking place in the proximal part, that is leading to the mucus stagnation at a for example at the distal part, mucus is stagnated there. So when the mucus is stagnated, the pressure will be increasing because mucus is continuously secreting on the walls. So that pressure of vessels and nerves, this will pressurize the on the vessel and nerve that are surrounding the appendix, and in due to that pressure the pain appears, and after that the bacteria will multiply and lead to inflammation and pus formation, and first of all serous exudate will appear, and later on purulent form of inflammation will also take place. Now there is an important classification, or you can say these are some pathological presentation of acute appendicitis. So there are four you can say classification of acute appendicitis. First is cataral, second is phlegmanous, third is gangrenous, and fourth is perforated. So the cataral acute appendicitis is simple, and it is just you can say located till the surface of the acute appendicitis. while the phlegmenous, gangrenous and perforated, these are destructive forms. So they are usually occurring after the complications. For example, the perforated is usually a complication, but these are occurring after the catarrhal. After the catarrhal will be occurring phlegmenous, after phlegmenous will be occurring gangrenous. But in some cases gangrenous can occur without the involvement of these two also. So what are the pathological features of each these types? So now we will learn that in detail. So first of all, catarrhal is basically in this appendix is slightly thickened and the serous membrane is hyperemic. That means the blood is supplying properly. So serous membrane is hyperemic, appendix is slightly thickened in this case, and small amount of serous exudate in the abdomen cavity. So there will be small amount of serous exudate present in the abdominal cavity, and leukocytes and fibrin coating will be present in the surrounding tissues. So leukocyte infiltrates and fibrin coating around the surrounding tissue will be present in case of catarrhal. And if we see histologically, the small areas of epithelial destruction we will see under the microscope. So this is all about catarrhal classification. Now the second is phlegmenous. Phlegmenous usually occurs after catarrhal passes. So whenever someone is suffering from, for example, initial stage of acute appendicitis, catarrhal, then it will come to phlegmenous. It will spread to all layers, and in this case purulent exudate will be formed and it will be cloudy, like due to the pus present, because pus is present, and that will lead to emphysema formation. So peritoneum of the right iliac fossa, RIF means right iliac fossa, is also cloudy and turbid. Turbid is the same meaning that it is cloudy, that we can't see. And sharply thickened and tense hyperemic fibrin coating. So appendix will be sharply thickened, tensed, hyperemic, and fibrin coating is also present over the appendix. So histologically, if we will see under the microscope, there will be thickening of walls, increase in leukocyte infiltration, and ulceration of the mucous membrane in case of phlegmenous acute appendicitis. Now the third is gangrenous. So gangrenous, what happens in gangrenous acute appendicitis? It is basically necrosis of the some area, or you can say the wall appendix. It can also occur due to thrombosis of appendiceal mesenteric vessel. As I already told you earlier, that gangrenous doesn't need these two. It can occur in case of thrombosis also. So if any thrombus will come and it will occlude the appendiceal mesenteric vessels, for example the appendiceal artery or ileocolic artery, then in that case the gangrenous form will occur without the involvement of phlegmenous or catarrhal form. So there will be the purulent exudate will be formed in this case, and sharp stinking odor will be present, and also the appendix will be dirty green or black in color due to the gangrene. And there is also involvement of the surrounding organs, and hemorrhages are also present on the peritoneum and can occur without catarrhal or phlegmenous. For example, emboli of artery ileocolic, as I already told you earlier. So this is the classification of acute appendicitis. Now, if the patient came, so first we have to see, like when the patient is coming to us, so what are the clinical picture and diagnosis? For example, if you are a doctor and the patient is coming to you, so what will be the complaints and the symptoms that patient will be having? So first of all, pain. Initially there will be pain in the epigastric area around the umbilicus. So in the initial stage, when the you can say the appendicitis attack starts, in that case epigastric, initially it will be starting from the epigastric area around the umbilicus, and this is known as Kummel's symptom. So first of all, epigastric area around umbilicus, then it will radiate, or you can say spread to right iliac fossa. So initially epigastric around umbilicus, this is known as Kummel's symptoms, and then it will go to right iliac fossa. Also the pain depends on the location of the appendix also, like for example, in the first page I have told you, I'll show you again, this the locations of the appendix, like if it is in pelvic or retrocecal or posterior or preileal, or it can be in subcecal. So the position also depends, like in which part of the abdomen the appendix is present, the pain will also be present in that part also. So in emphysema, for example, in pus formation, there will be high intensity pain. The pain will be of very high intensity, while in case of gangrene, the pain is slightly decreased because gangrene will lead to the damage to the nerve fibers. So the nerve endings will be damaged and the pain will be quite, you can say, dull or decreased. And in case of perforation also, there is sharp and sudden increase of pain. And in case of uncomplicated appendicitis also, there is dull, nagging and constant pain is present. So this is the main characteristic of pain in case of appendicitis. So the second symptom that the patient might have is vomiting. So vomiting, it can be like recurrent vomiting can also be present, and also after vomiting the patient will not feel better. So this is a characteristic of the vomiting in case of appendicitis. Third, fever will be present. So the fever characteristic, it depend upon stage of inflammation. Or I have already told you about cateral, phlegmanous, gangrenous and perforated. So like if it is cateral, there will be the pain, the fever will be less severe, or you can say less hectic. But in case of phlegmanous, it will be hectic fever because of the pus formation. So now what is this? This is a Murphy triad. Murphy triad consists of pain. First of all, pain will appear in the patient. Second, vomiting. And third will be fever. So this is known as clinically Murphy triad. And also there is a classical Sitkovsky sign. What is this sign? That the patient prefer to lie on the right side. So the patient always prefer to lie on the right side, but when he rotate to the left, there is increase in pain due to the displacement of the appendix and cecum part. So this is known as Sitkovsky sign. So it is quite important sign in case of patient who are having appendicitis. Next, other symptoms can be constipation and later diarrhea, because appendix is constantly irritating the nerve endings, and it can lead to intestinal paresis also. So, and also dysuria can also be present if the appendix, for example, the appendix is touching the urinary bladder. So in that case, the urinary bladder sensitivity will also be disturbed. In that case, dysuria can also be present in such patients. Also, weakness, malaise and loss of appetite will also be present. Now these are some clinical the symptoms that we will see, like, or the patient will tell. For example, when the patient will come, he will say, I am having pain, vomiting, fever, maybe diarrhea or constipation or something like that. But what are the abdominal examination that we should carry out? So these are some important abdominal examination that a doctor should carry out so that he can differentiate appendicitis, or you can say diagnose the appendicitis properly. So first of all, there will be a localized tenderness at the McBurney's point. So the McBurney's point, for example, if this is our abdomen and this is our umbilicus, so here will be our superior anterior iliac spine. And at this point, just here, this is the McBurney's point. This is the McBurney's point. So there will be localized tenderness at this McBurney's point. Second, the rebound tenderness, or you can say rigidity in the right iliac fossa. So in this area, in the right iliac fossa, there will be rigidity will be present. Or rebound tenderness mean whenever the doctor will palpate this area, and there will be rebound tenderness, our muscles will be rebounding, there will be tenderness will be present. It is a kind of, you can say, involuntary action by our muscles. Third is Schadkin-Blumberg sign. So what is Schadkin-Blumberg sign? It is when it is increase in pain when hand is withdrawn. That means when we are palpating this area and when we will remove our hand, in that case the pain will be increased. So this is Schadkin-Blumberg sign. This will also be present. Another is Rasdolsky sign. So what is Rasdolsky sign? So this is tenderness by percussion over the focus of inflammation. For example, if inflammation is here or here, so wherever we will you can say we will do percussion like this, if we will do, then over that area there will be focus of inflammation. Next is Rosing sign. Rosing sign, that the increase of pain in right iliac fossa when pushing the left iliac fossa. So this is basically, let me explain you to you simply. For example, if I am if this is a patient and he came to me, so if I you can say push here in the left iliac fossa, then the patient will feel pain here. Why? Because as you know, we have ascending colon, transverse colon and descending colon here. So there is gas present in that part. So whenever I will push, or you can say palpate deeply in this area, the gas will move here and it will irritate the vermiform appendix and the cecum. So there will be pain in the right iliac fossa whenever we will deeply palpate in the left iliac fossa. Next sign will be Bartomeyer-Michelson sign. What is this sign? That is increased tenderness in right iliac fossa by palpation of patient on left side lying. When the patient is lying on the left side, then there will be increased tenderness in the right iliac fossa. Seventh sign is Obrestow's sign. So there is increase in tenderness in right iliac fossa when patient lying on back, like for example we are normally sleeping in that case, and raising its right leg. Whenever he raises his right leg, then the vermiform appendix will be, like its nerve ending will be irritated, and in that case there will be tenderness and pain is present. That is Obrestow's signs. And finally, we will also have to do rectal examination. For example, if the position of the appendix is retrocecal or pelvic position, in that case some of these signs may not be present. So we have to do rectal examination to confirm the diagnosis of the acute appendicitis. So this is all about clinical picture and diagnosis.